start you with a really nice question. What do you think is your greatest artistic achievement?
No question. It is my monumental sculpture, which monumentals are over 18 foot high. I was asked, exactly this time last year, I was asked, could I do a very large piece? I said, what do you mean, very large? They said they want a statement. I said, okay. So we did, I did, a twist and turns piece. Twist and turns is a piece which is all about life's twists and turns. It's all about moving in different directions. And I did it at Dendered Up, just under 20 foot high. And that is at the front of a country estate in Lancashire. And we needed a crane. It was a massive teamwork. And it's all about, it's not just looking at the finished result of a monumental piece. It's about the underneath, it's about the structure. It's because the underneath, which the buyer doesn't see, has got to be as sound as what has the sculpture on top. So structure engineers that have to work out the weight that goes underground, and so it has the right balance. Because this piece is on right at the top of a hill, and all the wind from Blackpool and everything gets at it, it's very important that the foundations are as solid as the piece on top. So yeah, when I look at that and I think, oh, I've achieved that, I would say without question, it's the magical part of my career.
That's amazing. I'd love to see that piece.
Yeah.
It looks amazing. It looks amazing.
Do you have any memorable experiences of seeing people engage with your art?
Plenty. Plenty. Yeah. Some people look at certain pieces of my work, some of the white series, and they can start crying because they can relate to the picture, and it has quite a spiritual, moving connotation. And yeah, I can see people smile, I can see people cry, I can sometimes see people say, but I find that's good, because I really feel that whatever people feel, it shows more about them, and the picture can really show what the viewer is about.
And how do you feel that your work, how do you feel that your work has changed over the years?
It's definitely changed. But I'm never frightened of putting anything on a canvas. I am a person who likes to experiment. And yes, my work's evolved. My early work was very geometric, because I adore Kandinsky. And I adore Gerhard Richter, which is what I would like to think my Chaos and Structure series has been influenced by. It's about feelings. I like to project my feelings onto the canvas and explore myself.
Mm-hmm. And you briefly mentioned the primitive woman sculpture, which is going to be featured in the November show. It's just a quick look to the future from here. So could you tell us more about how the sculpture came to be, at sort of what point in your life, what inspired you to create the sculpture, and what the particular surfaces of the piece mean to you, and why they're there?
The primitive woman was not at the beginning of my career. I would say not quite halfway through, but around there. It's very important to me because it's powerful. It's about two halves. To me, it's like two halves of a woman. An and I believe if you look at it, it's raw, it's the raw bronze in the middle, which if you look at most people, they have a vulnerable part to them, and they have like a raw part. The outside of the primitive woman is smooth because she's coming together and she's becoming more powerful and she's reaching out to the modern world. She's very much a piece about primitive times and she's striding forward into modernity. The back of the piece is quite raw. As she gets smoother, it's really trying to become complete and moving forward. The patina on the piece is obviously all bronze, but it's a grey-white patina, which is the hardest of all the patinas to do. But as I said earlier, I always push boundaries, and it's a grey-white, quite a pure patina.
Okay, great, thank you. And you've said that your favourite artists are...
I adore Tapias. I like Anselm Kiefer. If you said who is my favourite, it has to be Gerhard Richter.
Mm-hmm.
I can stand at a Gerhard Richter exhibition and I'm just in awe of his work. I just love it. But in all fairness, I mustn't forget Kandinsky. When you look at his work and think those pigments are not like the pigments we get today, they were crushed lapis lazuli in order to get the blue pigment, and you look at his work and you think he did that geometric abstraction so long ago, and you think, oh, was that painted now? When you can't believe it was painted 60, 70, 80 years ago, and the depth of the colour in his pigments, I think he's magical, absolutely magical.
Mm-hmm. And finally, can you let us know about your plans for 2015, what exhibitions you might have, and the body of work that you're embarking on?
Okay. I'm always up for challenges. I'm not going to share it with you now, but I'm moving on to the next phase, which incorporates my sculpture, incorporates my white series, and something quite interesting I'm doing for an exhibition opening in 2016 in New York and Los Angeles. I've also been offered a solo exhibition in London, May 2016, and I'm just exploring myself again. I'm on a journey and I feel that journey is moving again. And you can turn left, you can turn right, and you think you know where you're going, and then all of a sudden a new idea springs into your head. But that is art. That is, it's very exciting. I have travelled intensely studying my art. I've studied most of the Guggenheims, I've studied in Barcelona, in New York, in Bilbao, Berlin, and now I'm off to New York next month because I've got talks in New York, and I start exploring again. So yeah, it's going to be quite a busy year for me.
That's great. Well, thank you very much.